Hi, and welcome to our first video on the endocrine system. If you're joining us for free on YouTube, just like all of our other anatomy and physiology videos, we release half our content for free, while we make all the rest of the lessons available exclusively at MrFordsClass.net. This allows us to make future videos as well as pay our rent and keep our lights on. So be sure to check out that site. Once again, it's MrFordsClass.net. Moving on, let's actually get into our topic, and that is the endocrine system. The endocrine system, endocrine, means inside secretions. Endo means inside, crine means to secrete. If you recall from previous videos in the histology section, specifically the epithelial tissue, you remember that we had two types of glands. We had exocrine glands, which had ducts, and endocrine glands, which were ductless. This is what we're going to take a look at in this series of videos, the ductless glands, the endocrine glands. The endocrine glands are composed of hormone-producing glands. For example, the pituitary gland, the thyroid gland, the parathyroid gland, the adrenal gland, and more. The functions of the endocrine system is to regulate body activities. It's kind of like the nervous system in that they both regulate body activities, but the endocrine system does it different. In fact, the endocrine system uses hormones to make the changes, to affect change within the body. Hormones are chemical substances secreted into the internal bodily fluids by a cell or group of cells. So we've already talked about hormones a couple of times so far. So what exactly is a hormone? A hormone is an organic compound. It can either be, in general, a steroid or a non-steroid. If it's a non-steroid, it can be a protein or peptide, or it can be an amine, which is derived from the amino acid thyrosine. So we have steroids and non-steroids. Within this non-steroid category, we have proteins and peptides, and we also have the amines, which again is the amino acid derived from the thyrosine. The functions of the hormone, it has several functions: homeostasis, homeostatic mechanism. If you recall from lesson one in our series of videos, we took a look at homeostasis, the body's desire to resist change, to make sure everything's kind of back towards the middle, everything is kind of maintained. Well, the hormones and the endocrine system does that. It deals with growth and development. Growth, again, from lesson one, being an increase in the size of something, while development is the maturation process. In humans, probably one of the most visible and obvious maturation processes is puberty. And the endocrine system pretty much runs puberty. Reproduction, the continuation of the species. Besides causing people to go through puberty, hormones are also responsible for the creation and development of gametes. And we'll take a look at gametes in further detail later on. It deals with emergencies, if you take a look at the stress response. It can be synergistic and antagonistic. Synergistic in that it helps other hormones, or antagonistic in that it opposes other hormones. So let's go back briefly to our two broad categories of hormones, and those were the steroids and the non-steroids. If it's a steroid hormone, it is a hormone that has a steroid nucleus similar to the base structure of cholesterol. In fact, steroid hormones are derived from cholesterol. The non-steroid hormones, the proteins and peptides, they can be amino acids or proteins. Now think about this. If you remember from the cell biology series of lessons, and I know that was quite some time ago, but we looked at ribosomes. Ribosomes produce proteins. Ribosomes can be found around the cell, but they like to hang out around the rough endoplasmic reticulum. So a protein hormone is being made by ribosomes on the rough ER. So the rough endoplasmic reticulum creates the protein and peptide hormones. Then the other type of non-steroid hormone were the amines. These again were derived from the amino acid thyrosine. These are produced in the thyroid and the adrenal medulla. We will take a look at the individual glands in other videos. We'll take a look at the location and the anatomy of these glands, and we'll also take a look at the hormones that they produce. So we'll get to that in future videos. let's talk about hormone control. This is how hormones do their job. First of all, a hormone is secreted and controlled typically by negative feedback. Again, if you recall from lesson one, we talked about homeostasis and the feedback mechanisms. We took a look at positive feedback, which is a cascading reaction. It gets more and more powerful. In fact, we do find positive feedback mechanisms in the hormones, mostly when we're dealing with the reproductive system. But in general, the endocrine system and the hormones work by negative feedback. They receive information and they make adjustments accordingly. They're trying again towards that homeostasis. Endocrine glands in general tend to over-secrete hormones, which cause the target cells to function. There's a new word for us, target cells. Target cells are what the hormones are going to make something happen with. That's where the magic happens. The hormone is going to interact with a target cell, and that target cell is going to express the changes. That's what's being controlled. We have other methods of control. For example, we have tropic hormones. Tropic hormones interact with other glands. They tell other glands to do something. The hypothalamus controls the anterior pituitary. That stimulates other glands. So the tropic hormones make other glands do something. The nervous system also controls the endocrine system. The nervous system will stimulate some glands directly. And we also have some glands affecting other glands. Some glands respond to changes caused by hormone secretions of those other glands. In our next video, we're going to take an even closer look at how hormones do their jobs. Specifically, we're going to start taking a look at the messengers. So that's our next video.